Who cares why they did this?
The government's last breath in their summation was, it was essential to American security to prosecute these four men. But my client insisted that he never did something without the government pushing him to do it. And I knew that if the jury could see that, the jury could believe that this case was a real entrapment case and they would exonerate the defendants. I also believed that the chance of that happening was extraordinarily slim. Bombs and missiles and a culture of violence in the city of New York, where thousands of people died, would be a very, very hard sell.
They used us. They really used us. Put a dark mark on us. And this is a government that I love, but I'm going to speak the truth about the government no matter what.
What I found out fighting David Case and fighting for the Newburgh Four, that it was more cases. I'm like, oh, so they've been doing this a while.
Another case of suspected homegrown terror, another U.S. citizen plotting to blow up Americans. Today it was 21-year-old Antonio Martinez, a.k.a. Muhammad Hussein, a recent convert to Islam.
What's up, world? It's your man, Mr. Sam 44 Man, seen in over 202 countries and provinces
around the world.
You're tuned in to the Detroit Raw Show.
Right here, only on YouTube.
You know what, world? Today, I'm about to unleash some information to you that y'all are really going to open your eyes and raise your eyebrows to. Conspiracy. Entrapment. United States of America. Government. Black men. Terrorism. All these factors are going to be included in what I'm going to show you today. And I'm also tell you some bullshit that's going on in our inner cities that we just don't even know about. But I'm going to tell you today, check this out. You're tuned in to the Detroit Raw Show, one of the hottest shows seen in the city of Detroit, coming out of the city of Detroit with me, your man, the one and only, Mr. Sam 44 Man. Y'all come on back and check this shit out that I got for you. You're tuned in to Detroit Raw right here, only on YouTube.
right here, only on YouTube.
What's up, world? Your man, Mr. Sam 44 Man, back here with ya. Hey, y'all miss me? Of course you did. That's a crazy question to ask, especially when I got me 796 subscribers. Y'all gonna make sure I get me 1,000 subscribers before you know it. Hey, but I work hard, and best to believe, every one of those views, every one of those subscribers, and everything you see coming up out of here is 100. I don't pay for subscriptions, and I don't pay for subscribers. I get views, original at that. So, hey, I don't cheat. I do it right, 100%. But dig this here, you know, world, my God is something else. And I say that, and I keep saying that to y'all because of the simple fact of this. See, I look at signs, world, and I don't see the world like you may see it. I see the world differently. And let me explain. Where you can't see something, I can see it clearly. You understand? So when all this racial shit that's going on right now, y'all probably wonder, like, how do you have so much insight? Because one, I'm 50 years old. Two, I live the shit. So I'm watching it all over again as an older man. So that's the killer part about it. But the newfangled way of the way these motherfuckers is doing shit, world, I gotta let y'all know, because some of y'all getting caught up in this shit, and I don't want to see that happen to you. Do any of y'all, world, out there go on the internet, y'all see y'all email, shit like that, and it's always something that you can make some money, earn some money, give up this, do this, pay for this, you can earn some money. Okay, I came into one of these situations where, dig this, I want you to check this information out first, and then I'm gonna show you, or at least tell you what I'm talking about. Check this out. Just seen that shit. Said I won $14.5 million from the Echo Bank of Nigeria. Now, peep this. What I'm about to show you today is the entrapment situation that's going on in this world, in this country, and on the black race. And I want you to listen carefully, and I want you, if you got young kids and even teenage younger kids, I want you to put them up to the fucking computer, and I want you to listen to this, and I want you to watch this, world, because, hey, I don't know how this is gonna go. I really don't. But what I'm gonna show you is on YouTube, so you can check it out even if you don't see it on my show. It's called the Nuremberg Sting. The Nuremberg Sting happened back in 2008, where four black men were convicted of being terrorists in Nuremberg that didn't have no money, no opportunity, and really not no education. Hear me now. This is a government individual that is working for the United States government that came into our ghetto neighborhood to recruit some black men. Now, he had C4s, rocket launchers, and all this kind of shit that, mind you, I just said these black men didn't have the money for, but the government was providing, this government informant was providing this to these individual men. The killing part about it, world, is they all got 25 years. The motherfucking informant, he walked away scot fucking free. And as a matter of fact, he got fucking paid, world. He got paid. paid for entrapping niggas. See, y'all wanted to get deep with this religion shit about Islam, and I told you I'm Muslim, and I'm not gonna go for it. So therefore, by me being a Muslim, it's my right and it's my duty to prove just how vicious you motherfuckers that's trying to demise my religion really are. So I'm doing that. All praise is due to Allah. You know how it works in me? Back to how God was working in me this morning. I went to bed last night early, probably about 10 o'clock. When I went to bed last night, I woke up a little bit earlier than I usually wake up. I usually wake up 5, 6 in the morning. Today I woke up at 3, not because I wanted to, but it was like I was forced to get up. It was like, get up, like it's 3 o'clock in the morning. I ain't trying to get up at 3 o'clock, I just went to bed. But you know, that's a sign. That's that sign from God that you gotta listen to. Get your ass up. You don't wanna get up? Okay, I'm gonna make something happen. Whoop, now I gotta go to the bathroom. You feel me? Now you're really gonna get up. So okay, I got up and I turned on the television and I seen this documentary that was on HBO called The New Bird Sting. And after I sit back and watch it, world, I couldn't believe that the United States government entrapped these four black men. They entrapped them, flat out entrapped them. And now the guys was more or less, and I'm not even gonna say that the brothers wasn't wrong. But let me ask you this. If somebody come to you and say, I want to blow up something and I'm going to do it in 3 weeks and I'm going to give you $250,000, what are you going to do? What would you say? These brothers wasn't out to do nothing but to make some mayhem, cause some scare going on. They didn't want to kill nobody, and you'll see it. Evident. They said it. Look, we just going to make some noise, blow up some shit. We ain't going to hurt nobody because we ain't looking to hurt nobody. But my man said jihad. That means somebody got to die. And this is the government informant. He's egging it on, world, how they got to get these Muslims and how they got to get these brothers and how they got to get this together. And then he didn't give them no money. And then turned the script on him. He flipped the script on us by saying, if you are in this for money, you're not in this for Allah. You're in it for money. And this is not for money. This is for jihad. That's what he's doing in their face. Now they sitting in the penitentiary doing 25 fucking years, and this motherfucker is who knows where free. And he set these guys up. He participated in the crime that they did. He organized the crime with them. He got the weapons from the United States of American government and entrapped these black guys. He entrapped them. It's straight in your face. So without further ado, I want you to take a look at this, world, and then we're going to come back and we're going to discuss some of this bullshit. You're tuned in to the Detroit Wild Show with your man, Mr. Sam 44 Man. Check this shit out.
Says it has thwarted a terror plot.
Federal investigators say the suspects are four men with a shared hatred for America.
According to the FBI, the four men intended to carry out their plan today.
We targeted four individuals that planned and schemed to bomb two Jewish facilities here in the Bronx and also to take down a military aircraft up at the Stewart Airport.
They stated that they wanted to commit jihad.
Prosecutors described the suspects as extremely violent men who embraced every opportunity for terrorism. The suspects, 55-year-old James Cromartie, the alleged ringleader, 28-year-old David Williams, 32-year-old Onta Williams, and LeGarry Payen, all of Newburgh. Investigators say the four Muslim men met in prison and hatched the terrorist plot at a local mosque.
These guys were homegrown Americans living among us, and this is just one cell of many. The FBI is worried about all sorts of things around the country.
The good news here is that our FBI and our NYPD did a very, very good job. The fact that we've been able to penetrate these groups early on, they were being monitored for close to a year.
This is truly a textbook example of how a major investigation should be conducted.
Where you're from, and when you say Newburgh, the response and the reactions that you get is almost like offended. You're like, you know, you feel embarrassed to be from here, you know, the way people act, like, oh, Newburgh. You see the streets, you know, the homes. For every actually living space in Newburgh, there's like five condemned, you know.
I remember as if it was yesterday, we were right up in this area, right here, and I remember he was sitting right over here on that side, and it was the table here, and he made his statements that a woman should not be seen or heard. And it was like, is this how he introduced himself to us? He's going to tell us women should not be seen or heard? He gave us this persona as though he was a businessman. And he would come in different fine cars. I've seen him in a BMW. I've seen him in a Hummer. I've seen him in a Mercedes-Benz. And you got a lot of people around here who don't have no work. They don't have money. They don't have anything. And he would maybe take $50 out and buy so many lunches and just give them to people.
I first met him, it was on a Friday. I'd done the Juma here, the Friday press service here. And I met him out here in this very parking lot. I said, can I help you? He said, yeah. I'm sure you can tell me, you know, about jihad. That of all the things for him to be concerned about, he would ask about jihad, he would ask about a holy war.
And we asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect his people from any more harm.
I did tell different individuals, I said, stay the hell away from him. Some ain't right about it.
Shahed Hussein, he claims, is his real name, although nobody knows. His background is for bankruptcy, felony arrests, lying on his immigration papers. He had become fluent in the language of jihad.
The
like, look, this guy can come around here as much as he wants because he's not going to be able to get anybody here. Everybody here is straight. So it was a shock that he hung around long enough to be able to get somebody to buy into his plot.
When Hussein first approached James Cromedy in the parking lot of the Newburgh Mosque, he presented himself as a wealthy Pakistani who had come to the United States to meet people. And Cromedy says, in the biggest mistake of his life, those look like Pakistani shoes. And Shahed Hussein says, they are. Do you know about Pakistani shoes? And James Cromedy says, I've been to Pakistan, which he'd never been to. And so he knew about these shoes. He maybe saw them on TV and CNN. They then struck up a relationship that went on for months.
This
is Beamer.
This is the BMW?
Yeah.
You got it painted?
Not that one. This is the other Beamer.
Oh, yeah, it's the other one.
Right.
I'm about to say, yeah, that's right. You got two Beamers.
Yeah,
that's right.
I got two Beamers.
I thought you had a Mercedes, too.
Oh, yeah, I got a Mercedes.
Huh?
I have a Mercedes.
Right? You can pull the seat back, huh? Yeah. Ooh! I'm talking about this. Ah!
So we have the money here?
Yes.
To someone like Mr. Cromedy, who had spent his entire life in poverty, trying to support himself as a very low-level marijuana dealer, also working the night shift at Walmart, making about $14,000 a year, I mean, that was a very big thing to him, Mr. Shahed Hussein's wealth. And Hussein played on that tremendously.
What is your understanding that you make a lot of money and still be on the side of Allah?
That'll be good, but I have to know what I'm gonna do to make the money.
I have a lot of ideas, okay, for you, okay?
James, he lived around the corner. You know, down the street and around the corner in the projects over there. He struck me as somebody who liked to hear himself talk.
I got a 10 murder. I did 15, 10 or 20, so. He was only 12 years old, so imagine what I'd do to a grown man. He was 12 years old, the kid I shot. I don't care if he was 3 years old. If he pulled a gun on me, I'm gonna take him down.
James talked for hours, talking about crimes that he committed that never happened, talking about things that he had done that he had never done to impress Shahed Hussein.
That whatever you need me to do, and if she's a mullah, I'm gonna do it. And I'm gonna get away with it.
And Shahed Hussein introduced the idea that he was connected to JEM, Jaish-e-Mohammed, and which is a legitimate terrorist organization that's on the United States watch list.
Jaish-e-Mohammed Jihad, because they are funding each and everything.
Sure.
So they are funding the money, so it's their show, you know, and let them run the show. So, I mean, everything comes from there. So the cars, the money. In your mind, were your best targets here in New York?
The best targets already been hit.
Okay, now, but what do you think you could do? The best targets you will have in your mind?
I would like to hit the bridge.
But bridges are too hard to be hit because of their made of steels.
I renamed you two places last week.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like you ignored me.
Mm-hmm.
I do have a brain. The brain that there, I do have one of those.
This is the Riverdale Temple.
Riverdale Temple.
As a matter of fact, yes, the Riverdale Temple.
Yeah. This is good. This is excellent. We because how can you go wrong? Everything is right there.
I hate those bastards. No disrespect. Those fucking Jewish bastards.
If you can get some people, it'd be nice. Maybe a body, it'd be nice. Okay?
Do you have to use that word, body?
It's body. B-O-D-D-E-Y-U-E-W-X-Y-Z.
No.
Good Muslim brothers would be nice, you know?
James Cromedy, this is a guy who has spent some time in prison for drug crimes, not for violent crimes. And it seems like Cromedy thinks that he hit the jackpot. Unfortunately, to Hussein, Cromedy doesn't seem all that interested in actually going through with the plot.
But you said that you would be good to get some brothers together.
Don't worry about the brothers. Don't worry. You're going to meet some brothers. This means...
Inshallah, I'm hoping we can do it.
Don't worry about it, brother. Just hold your seat.
Are you sure, brother, you can get the brothers? I'm trying. Just like you said, Allah makes things happen.
True.
Maybe it's not my mission then.
So what do you think I should say to my guys back in New York?
Tell your brothers we need some more time. That's what you need to tell them. I want to recruit a guy. I want to get some guy. Well, just let me just try one more thing,
Aki.
Okay. Let me just try one more thing. If not, don't worry about it. I'll call it off.
In 2009, James Cromedy kind of goes AWOL. For a long time, he goes out of contact with Hussein. Hussein starts calling Cromedy. Cromedy's not answering. Hussein goes to the mosque. No sign of Cromedy. He starts asking people at the mosque, have you seen James? Have you seen James? He goes around Newburgh. Have you seen James? And Shahid Hussein hears that James Cromedy is back around.
Hello. You remember me now? Talk to
no,
me.
No, brother.
You could talk to me.
Listen to me. Listen to me. I don't left the place and everything. I just left.
I can make you $250,000, but you don't want it. What can I tell you?
We can laugh. Okay, come see me, brother.
250,000? $250,000 means no more Newburgh. This is a small city just soaking and drowning in poverty. Me and your kids are struggling, and you know, you're in debt up to your ass. Somebody offers you a large chunk of change. Fresh out of jail. I'm interested in what its idea. Okay, what's it about? What do we got to do?
Salaam alaikum. Khatija.
Thank you, brother. The family love you, brother. Huh? The family love you, brother.
For the money or for the cause?
They would do it for the money.
They're not even thinking about the cause.
I was about 5 years old when my parents asked me what I was going to do with my life. When I told my parents I was going to go to law school and join the FBI, my mother only heard the law school part, my father only heard the FBI part, and both of them were happy. And a friend of mine had a case against neo-Nazi skinhead groups, and I looked very young, and I had blonde hair and blue eyes. So I've spent most of the next 12 years working undercover in some form or another. Having worked terrorism for 12 years, I found that it was really everything that I wanted it to be until September 11th, unfortunately. The mood within the FBI after 9/11 was that the rules don't apply anymore.
The FBI was being threatened with being carved up. We're going to create MI5 out of part of the FBI. But the one message that was clear, and for me and the other FBI executives at the time, it was there will be no tolerance for another terrorist attack in this country under any circumstances.
Immediately after 9/11, I mean, there were actually FBI agents going through the hallway saying, the rules are off now, the rules are off. And I remember saying to one, what rules are you talking about? You know, are you talking about the Constitution? Do you think the Constitution is off? So, unfortunately, part of what the FBI did was treat the entire Muslim community as suspect.
This is David when he was a baby, and he still looks the same. He was just such a cute baby. He was a really happy kid, really, really happy kid. This is David when we first came to Newburgh. Look at that sweet little face. This is where David would come and hang out with all these little kids that say hello to you. He would teach them how to lift weights and stuff.
David's a sweetie. He's a sweetheart. You know, got a kind soul. Went through changes and struggles in his life, like all of us. We, you know, we're a dysfunctional family, like everybody else, you know, but we love each other to death. And when the drugs started hitting Newburgh, David became selling drugs, selling crack. Became this big man in Newburgh from his drug dealings. And then he went to jail for 5 years and came home and went to school, wanted to make a difference.
He was doing really, really good in college and going to school part-time. I was so proud of him. And then March 12th, I took my child to the hospital, and my son, Lord. And the doctor, he's never seen a case like this before. They say he needed a liver. They found some tumors in his liver.
At first, they was like, I have leukemia, then I had a blood cancer, I had thrombocytosis, sarcoidosis. David had came visit me, and I was just telling him that, yo, I'm mad scared. I never seen my brother cry. So, like, when I see him cry, that's when I kind of knew it was serious, because they kept telling me I had, like, all these things, but it didn't really sink in, like how bad it was. But when I see him crying, it was like, you know, this shit is real.
David thought that money would help get Lord a liver when they took out that tumor. The tumor was the size of a watermelon. We don't got no fathers around, and that's my baby brother, and I want to help him.
David was outside crying, and James came up to him and asked him, why are you crying? He said, my brother's about to die, and my mother don't have the money. He said, wait, let me go talk to somebody I know. I was at the hospital. I get a phone call from David. He says, tell the doctors to go ahead. I got the money. He said, I met this Muslim brother that's going to help us. I just was like, if that's what you say. They're like, no, Ma, seriously, you can trust him. No, that's your friend. It's not my friend. It's just something shady. Whenever someone puts it out there and makes it so easy for you, and they tell you how much they love you and they don't even know you, their motives are something. Their intentions are something. They want something from you other than your friendship.
David Williams comes in, and Shahed Hussein says, let's go to the airport at Stewart Air Force Base. So they drive up to the airport and they look at the planes. Stewart Air Force Base is the base that sends Air National Guard and National Guard troops at the time over to Iraq and Afghanistan. And Shahed Hussein says, we should blow up one of these. How do you blow up one of these? Well, I can get you a missile.
The rocket launcher, not the Stinger.
Oh, you got a Stinger.
I got a Stinger, not a rocket launcher.
Stinger.
That's his son, right?
Mm-hmm.
His son. He's a silent, yeah.
I mean, in 20 minutes, they won't even know what happened. Yeah. The plane.
It could be people there. You wouldn't hurt nobody.
Somebody could be in that plane cleaning planes or something.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You want to just destroy property. You want to take lives.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Tell you that. Yeah, yeah. Me too.
That's what I'm saying.
We ain't for taking lives.
I know exactly what I'm saying. I'm landing trap. That makes perfect sense.
But like you said, around one.
Hussein told David that he needed some more people. Make sure they're Muslims. That's what he told David. Whoever you get, make sure they're Muslim, because they needed a driver. I'm like, wow. Just make sure they're Muslims.
You know, I remember, you know, years ago, we used to go after people we said were communists. Then we went after gang members, you know, during the whole war on drugs. And that literally led to the incarceration of a whole generation of African-American men. So now, okay, so Muslims are the new thing. When I was elected, I was the first Muslim ever to be elected to Congress. And we, you know, experienced a torrent of invective and hate and all that kind of, and suspicion and insult. And when you channel a vast array of law enforcement resources towards a particular community, no doubt you're going to get some bad actors, because there's bad actors in every community.
Listen, guess what? We got two more brothers, huh?
Mashallah.
Alhamdulillah, huh? I got two more brothers, huh?
Wow.
Alhamdulillah, huh?
That's good, wow.
Alhamdulillah.
Ante, I met Ante when I got older. And Ante was one of the older guys that I actually looked up to. We out there gangbanging, man. We out there riding on people, beating up people, not going to school, not working, you know. And he'd be like, yo, man, you know, you guys got to do something with yourself, you know what I mean? This ain't it, you know, like, this is better than this. I'm like, when you ain't got much and all you got is love, you know, that really counts. It really do count, like somebody does care.
Ante Williams was working at a factory, not making very much money. He did spend time in prison, never for anything violent. It was a sad life. It hadn't been a particularly successful life.
A lot of people say Newberg has a black cloud over him. I'm grateful for that, though, because it makes me appreciate what I have. And where I got that from is Ante.
Your man, Mr. Sam 44, man, back here with you. What you think? Huh? Fucked up, wasn't it? Can you believe, world, this is the type of shit that our federal government is doing to the black man? Oh, what did I say last time, y'all, when I was talking to y'all? Huh? What did I say? It's so hard to be black in America. It's so hard to be black in America. I told you, that's the way it is. Let me tell you something that happened to your boy. Now check this shit out, world. You know, DTE, our gas company, local gas company here in the state of Michigan. Now every month I make sure I pay them, all right? I got caught up in a little situation about my finances with the government, which they shouldn't have even took money out of my account, but they levied my account. So where I was gonna be on top, they just took me down. So what happened was, a little bit of extra money that I had that I could have paid this bill on from the DTE people, which is about $400 after I'd paid them already in the month of March, $500. They wanted another $400, talking about I owe this. I've been paying since January. I don't know how this came up. So now, all right, boom. I gave you $500. Now you wanted me to give you another $400. They cut my shit off, world. They cut my shit off today. Yeah. So I'm up here getting dressed. They cut my shit off. I'm tripping like, the fuck? You know, I call them up. They tell me, world, that my hold only lasted from March 22nd to April 1st. So now today is the 5th of April. And they thought that they was gonna cut my shit off and I was gonna sit back and be all fucked up. So what they told me is if I pay the past due balance, which was $738, that I could get my shit reconnected. Guess what? That was a goddamn lie. Let me tell you, world, how they played your mans. Okay, I went and got the $740. But check this shit out. These motherfuckers said I had to come up with another motherfucking $500 for a down payment so I could get the shit turned back on after I done gave you the motherfucking $740. Huh? Wait a minute, Mr. Sam 44, man. What did you just fucking say? I said, bitch, I paid $500 in March. Made an arrangement for a past due a balance, past due of $400-something. They threw an extra $300-something on top of that, made me pay $740 past due. Ain't even a new month yet. And then said on top of that shit, I had to pay another motherfucking $500 to get my goddamn lights and gas on. That's what the fuck I said, world. Now let me tell you something. The average black person wouldn't have been able to do that, world. You see, I ain't got my shit around my neck. I don't give a fuck about that shit. I'll take that shit off my neck in a heartbeat when it comes to taking my shit and keeping my shit afloat. The federal government is such a motherfucker, man. Y'all done took my motherfucking money. You took it illegally because my income is tax-free. But I make too much money for these motherfucking hunky motherfuckers. So therefore, you levied my bank account. I want all my motherfucking money back, world. But they telling me they don't think I'm going to get all my money back because the government can just take whatever the fuck they want. Now, do you understand a little bit about the terrorism that we all sitting back hating on a Islamic religion and what's forcing people to make these kind of decisions? I ain't saying that I support the terrorism, but let me ask you this. What the fuck would you do if your and your family is all fucked up? You and your family fucked up. What are you going to do, world? I'm not a young kid. I'm 50 years old. I got a family. I got people that believe in me. People that depend on me. I can't let them down. Why would I? Why? I can't do it. I'm a man. I cannot let my family down. My family is all I got. They depend on me. So therefore, I can't let them down. Not like a lot of you soft cotton candy ass motherfucking niggas out here. Y'all let y'all family down every motherfucking day. Straight up. I ain't that nigga. I take care of mine.